Okay, let's help me welcoming Deepak Rai on the stage. Deepak Sawhney on the stage.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you.
So I am here today to share with you about the neuroscience of leadership. So neuroscience of leadership, why is this subject becoming important in today's world? Let us ponder for a few seconds here and see why is this important. So what we have noticed is that today, the world is changing. Things are changing as they were changing in the past also. Improvements have been happening all through 60s, 70s, 90s, and 2000. Few things which are changing are that the pace of change is much faster and much rapid. Do you agree with me? What used to take 10 years earlier now takes 1 year now. And therefore, there are new challenges being thrown at the leaders who are in this room. There is another one more thing which is changing is about this new generation of workforce which is coming in. Especially the workforce which has come in since the 2000. We are called Gen X. People with gray hair, no hair, are called Gen X. Am I right? The next generation which has come into workforce, and some of you in this room also may be there, who have come into the workforce from 2000 onwards, they are called?
Millennials.
They are called Gen Y. And their way of working, their thinking is way different from how we have been brought up professionally. So therefore, if I have been brought up professionally in 1980s and 90s and 2000, and I want to apply what I have learned on these people, will it work? Yes or no?
No,
it won't work. So therefore, the challenges are becoming huge. And third dimension, which is all encompassing, is we call that today's world is a VUCA world. Have you heard of this term VUCA?
Yes.
Volatile? Uncertain? Complex, complexity and ambiguity. So therefore, so leadership is experiencing evolution, right? And therefore they are saying what new leadership requires are three, four things. Emotional intelligence was one subject which was covered probably in one more talk about 2 weeks back, which is you will find on the screen. Flexibility, are the leaders flexible or not? And flexibility has to be seen in many, many different dimensions. We are not getting into that. And finally, about your intelligence, which is about your creative thinking. Are we able to think creatively? Because if we continue to apply what we have learned, we may not be as effective as leaders in bringing about the change which is expected out of us professionally and in the organizations that we work with. And therefore, the context of this session is all about understanding how can we use our brains better. We are not saying use your brains more. What we are saying is, do we know how our brain functions? And the way my brain functions is also the way your brain also functions. And if I can find that out, then it gives me the flexibility, it gives me the strength, it gives me the power to be able to work with people, because then I know how they are likely to respond to any situation, any event, anything that I say to them. So what I will do is, now I will do three things after this. I will first talk to you about 6 insights about the brain, okay? I will take a pause, and then I will come back to you and say, having heard about those 6 insights, what is that one learning you have that you want to take back and apply at workplace? Make sense? After that, I will talk about 4 key behaviors that our leader is expected to demonstrate, right? And for each of those 4 behaviors, what aspects of our mind or brain working we should know to be able to exhibit those behaviors all the time at an optimal level. And after I finish each of these 4, again we will take a few minutes pause and reflect what is your learning, what is your takeaway, what are you going to do differently based on what you have understood. Fair? This we will do over the next 1.5 to maximum 1 hour 45 minutes. Make sense to you? Okay, so let us look at some insights about the brain. The first one is that the brain is a connection machine. Simple, understandable? Brain is making connections all the time. Right now you are making connections about the way I'm speaking, the way I'm talking, the way I'm moving, right or wrong? why brain makes connection. Brain makes connection because brain requires a lot of energy all the time to perform at a very optimal level. Brain also likes stability. Usko jyada wo pasand nahi hai, you know, going up and down. You know what I mean? Zigzag. It likes stability. So what it does is, it takes a lot of things from the environment that it sees, and without your even knowing sometimes, it will hardwire it. Hardwire ka matlab samajhte hai? Usko pakka kar lega. For example, I'll give you a simple example of hardwiring. It is hardwired in us how to drink water. We know how to drink water. It is not that every time we need water, we have to learn how to drink water. Makes sense to you? So brain hardwires it, because every time it has to learn, it has to use brain, and the energy will be lost. So therefore, brain is designed to make connections all the time. Making sense? Right? Nothing new in this? Right? Nothing new in this so far. But brain makes connection. What is the next one? Up and close, no two brains are alike. None in this room, not even your brother, not even your kid has a brain like you. We are all different. You all know this? Yes? No?
Yes.
So what is the implication for you as managers and leaders? If two brains are not similar, what is the implication for you as manager or leaders? Every person is unique and different, yes, but what is the implication? The implication is that if I tell you to do something because I think it is right, you don't think it is right. Because you have your own thinking process. The brain is not similar. And why is it not similar? Your brain is based on your experiences, your beliefs, your ecosystem experiences, and mine is different. Same brothers also maybe, living in the same house, right? So therefore the implication is that sometimes as managers, leader, we say, tumko itna bhi samajh mein nahi aata, nahi aayega. You know why? Because he's not like you. And therefore something more, much more has to be done to get people to understand what you think needs to be done. And in that process, you get them also to share sometimes. Making sense to you? Yeah? Let us look at the third one, which I already told you. The brain works to hardwire everything it finds useful. What is hardwiring? Hardwiring, you know, our brain is trillions and trillions of neurons and neurotransmitters inside, and there are various pathways inside. So when it sees something which it finds useful, right? Sometimes not even useful, it can't decide, it hardwires it. Let me take an example of sometimes perceptions we call them, but what is hardwired? You know, in India, typically, we have a view about how South Indians are, yes or no? We know how, sometimes we have a view about how North Indians are, how people in West and East are, right? Can you say it is hardwired in us? This is a North Indian, he is a jor se bolta hai, he is a show off, he drinks a lot, he will have chicken. South Indian, he won't have chicken. Hello, yes or no? Right? So what is brain doing when it experiencing people from different parts of the country? It is hardwiring whatever it can. Whether useful or not, we don't know. Sometimes it causes problem, doesn't it? When I went to Hyderabad for the first time, working in a company after Reliance, I used to work for Reliance for some time, I found that a lot of senior guys did not open up in front of me. They were all people from South. People from South handling different things. And I was the person going to Hyderabad. And it took me a lot of time to explain to them that I may be a North Indian, you may hold a view about me, but I am not that North Indian. I am a professional first before I am a North Indian, right? So it was hardwired in them. And I can't blame them for it. Right? I also had to work hard. So if it hardwires everything, remember, whatever you are saying is true on a subject and whatever I am saying is true, because the way I and you are hardwired. Both could be wrong, both could be right. Are we open to this thought that people can be right about something which I have a different view based on their views and perceptions? Make sense to you?
Yes.
Yeah. And therefore you find sometimes a lot of differences emerge in organizations. Yaar, wo aise bol raha hai, wo aise sochta hai, he does it this way. And we start labeling those views as people, that he's against my thought. But probably he's not. He's not against your thought. What is he doing? He's sharing his view from his experiences. Right? The next one is It drives automatic perception. The same example I give you. Hard wiring which gets into head drives automatic perception. So if I see a South Indian, I have already a picture in my head. I see a North Indian, I see a particular picture in my head. Drives automatic perception. So hard wiring draws automatic perception. We have to be aware of it. Why we should be aware of this? That hard wiring drives automatic perception. As manager's leader, everyone has hard wiring. It is driving automatic perception. Why should we as leaders be aware of this? Not only for ourselves, but for our people also. Because his solution to a problem is coming from his hard wiring, which is throwing up. This is how it is done. A lot of time, have you seen that when people come in new from a different organization, come to you, look at your system and say, "Isko aise nahi karte, aise karte hain." Does it happen? His hard wiring is of there. Your hard wiring is from this organization. You say, "Aise nahi hota yahan par." Right? And his perception comes automatically. He just looks at it and says, "This is all wrong." But you say, "No, it is all right. Your hard wiring is different." So be careful that people, perception is driven from their hard wiring. And unless you go to the hard wiring and let it surface, those perceptions are not likely to change. The next one, the fifth one is, it is practically impossible to deconstruct our wiring. Dangerous? That wiring which has happened in our head, it is not possible to deconstruct. Some people who just want to leave smoking, you know, a lot of people want to leave smoking. Hello? Right? What do? They decide one of the days that I'm not going to smoke anymore. Right? So what does our brain do? And this is the insight about the brain. Brain, wherever it goes, that thing gets hardwired. Remember I told you earlier, it hardwires everything it can. So if in your mind you start thinking that I have to leave smoking, leave smoking, leave smoking, it is becoming a harder wire. It is not breaking that wire of smoking, which means anytime you feel under stress, anytime you have finished a meal, you want to have a smoke. Am I right or wrong, people who smoke? Right? Because you are thinking more and more and more of smoking only. And therefore, what they say is that while it is difficult to deconstruct your wiring, but it is easy to create new wiring. So all those people who smoke but leave smoking, if you go and ask them what made them leave smoking, they will tell you that they thought of another story. So what is the implication of this when it comes to working in the corporate world, working in teams? How can you use this information that you cannot deconstruct old wiring, but you can create new wires? Where can you apply it? Where can you use it effectively? Sorry? Training of people, okay. Because you are now creating new wires. Wonderful. Where else can you use this idea that you cannot deconstruct the old wire, but you can create new wire? Unlearning, yeah. In fact, yesterday somebody asked me a question. Somebody in this room asked me a question that, how do we unlearn? What does neuroscience tells us about unlearning? Is that person in the room? And I replied the same thing, that for learning new things, you have to unlearn a lot, they say. And we say, don't need to unlearn, keep it there. But now create new wires. Create new wires. And that new wire is that there is something more to be done here. Right? A lot of people may have come into this room, and I'm closing this part, with certain thinking in their head. You must be carrying some perception about this session, yes or no?
Yes.
We're carrying it, right? Where was it coming from? Whichever perception you had, where was it coming from? Past experiences, right? Now that you are here and you had a perception which was, let us say, not positive, it was negative. But after coming into the room, what is that new wire you can create? You can't change that perception. You can't change that hard wiring. What is the new wire you can create to benefit from this program? What is the question you can ask yourself? There may be something new about this subject that is opening up a possibility of a new wire in you. Some of you attended emotional intelligence program, which happened 2 weeks back. Anyone? Some of you? Right? Now, in that, there is a concept called self-management. There is a self-awareness about how you feel, how you think, how much do you know yourself, and there is a concept of self-management. And that requires to be able to manage your emotions better, your strengths and weaknesses better, you have to ask yourself a question: what can I do now? And that question is such a powerful question, that question helps you create new wiring. Essentially, it is in your hand, it is in your brain that you can create new wires. As long as you know where is this perception coming from. A lot of times we don't even know where this perception is coming from. We just act like almost like a robot. There is another question which was asked of me, and I responded to say that almost 98% of the decisions that we take any day come from where, you know that? We don't think through those. They automatically come to us. Where are they coming from? Hardwiring, right? And therefore, a lot of problems keep appearing again and again, and we keep using our hardwiring to do it. And we have to change the way we have to handle problems, and so they don't recur, we will have to create new wires. We have to slow down and think, and I'll talk about that in the next section. People are coming from their own set of experiences and beliefs. Their brains are unique, and so are yours. And can you harness these brains? You talked about diversity. We talk about diversity in company. This is diversity at play. Diversity right in front of you. But you are saying my reality is the better reality than your reality. So be more open in that sense, yeah. Now let us go back to that question. There are two competing thoughts, right? Where are they appearing and occurring in our head? That's important. Those pieces, when two competing thoughts come, they happen only in this part of the brain. And this part of the brain is called prefrontal cortex. It doesn't happen here, it happens here. The next part is these four expectations from leaders, that the roles, the expectations from them. One is that they have to handle problems and take decisions, right or wrong? Yeah? The second one is they have to stay cool under pressure, right? Gussa na ho jaye, pressure mein aaye, stress mein aaye toh, right? They should stay cool and calm under pressure. Third one is collaborate. Collaboration is the name of the game. Today, those typically command control sort of roles are not working anymore. How can you influence people? How can people come together, give better ideas and improve things? And the last one is facilitating change. How do you bring about changes in organization? Change is the name of the game. It is happening all the time, right? How do you facilitate that? What do you need to know about a brain that you can make that happen relatively easier than today? We'll jump into the first one, which is about problems and decisions, right? So there are these two brains. One is called the working memory. Working memory is like your desktop, right? And working memory is this part of the brain. Matha, jise kehte hai na, ek tarah se, it's called prefrontal cortex. This is your working memory, right? And the other is your hard wiring, which is all lying here. And while you see there are several pieces of information, which is about 6-7. This part of the brain can handle about 6-7 pieces at one time. And this part of the brain handles trillions of pieces of information. Trillions. You don't even know sometimes what is all lying there. Right? Trillions. To give you a perspective about the size also, it is important here. If the size of your prefrontal cortex, this part of the brain, is 1 cubic feet, 1 cubic feet, what do you think is the size of your hardwired brain? Huh? 10 times, 1,000 times. It is actually Milky Way. You understand Milky Way? So you can just come back and see how small is this. Can you understand it now? How small is this? And it becomes important for us to know this because in this part of the brain, we do the following functions. It is so small. Remember, it is very small. And this part of our brain helps us understand things, helps us decide, it helps us recall, helps us memorize, and helps us inhibit. All this happening in this small part of the brain. This determines the success of leader. Because here is where the thinking is happening. Here is where decisions are being taken. Here is where those two competing thoughts will be processed. Those two competing thoughts will be processed in this part of the brain. Because if they don't come here, they never get resolved. There is no other part which is thinking, right? All your processing is happening here. So while all of them are simple, you understand the understand, you decide, recall, memorize, inhibit. What is inhibit? Any guesses here? This part, Hanji? Restrict. It helps us resist temptations. So this helps you resist temptations. It also helps you resist some of the behaviors. For example, a lot of times you can get angry. Can you? And then what do you do when you get angry? What is your next action or behavior? Hanji?
Lose temper.
You lose temper, right? Now, if your brain, this part of the brain can recognize that you are feeling right now angry, and because of that you will lose temper, raise your voice, the only this thing can only inhibit it. To say, no, it is not good to lose temper. No, it is not good to raise your voice in a team situation or with anybody, even at home with kids and family members, right? So this is a major piece of our brain called the prefrontal cortex or the working memory. So when you get thoughts here, only then you will process them. Like I said, most of the times your decisions are being taken here. We don't even sometimes, it hits us here. It comes, it immediately goes to the brain and all that hard wiring starts throwing out decisions to us. And therefore, a lot of times our lives do not change dramatically because we are allowing our past experiences to guide us even today. The situation is entirely different today. What was working 5 years back may not be relevant anymore. But we are not allowing those situations and those triggers to come to our prefrontal cortex and help us process them like he mentioned. There's a new thought coming in. Where will I process it? I have to process it here. When is a good time to take a decision? So you have to take your decisions here. What is a good time to take a decision for you? Hanji?
Anytime.
Because you don't know when the problem is going to crop up, you are expected to take decisions all the time, 9 a.m. to 9 p.m., am I right? What is an ideal condition for the brain to be to take good, optimal decisions? What is an ideal condition? Rest. Relaxed. Because that's when, why it requires is because of these four things. This part of the brain is very energy intensive. Remember I told you, it can hold about 7 things at max. And it is also think serially. You can't do 2 things or see 2 things or think 2 things simultaneously. You will think serially, you will jump. So it thinks serially, one after the other. It is very small, I have told you, very energy intensive, and last of all, it is fussy. Understand what is fussy? When you are in office and say, chhod yaar, abhi ek cigarette peeke aate hain. Because you have used up so much energy here, there is nothing left here to help you take, understand and take decisions. Does it happen to you during the day, during the week? You say, chhodo yaar, abhi, I can't think of anything else. Let me go and have a cup of tea or just go for a walk out. Does it happen? Yes or no?
Yes.
You can say no also. It is not important that you say yes. Right? Why? Because when you do this thinking, it gets fussy. And data tells us, research tells us that the zone of peak performance, now very important for you as leaders, the zone of peak performance is not more than about 2 hours. Constantly engaging your PFC on any issue beyond 2 hours will lead to deterioration. Can you see that inverted U? If you keep it in a constant state of arousal, beyond that 2 hours, the performance starts coming down. And if the performance of PFC comes down, what is getting impacted? Our ability to listen, understand, take decisions. Have you come across situations, and I'm trying to connect this neuroscience to your some of your practical things which happened to you. Have you come across a situation when you have gone with a very heavy subject to your boss at 5 p.m. and he says, chhod yaar, kal dekhenge. Hoga urgent, but kal dekhenge. Or it has happened with you, you have postponed it to next day. Has it happened with you? All the time. Because your brain is giving you a message, not a good time to discuss now. I'm not fit right now to be able to take this. What is the lesson for you as leaders and managers when you're working with your team members? The message is simple. If you keep your team members constantly aroused in their brain about this, you know, a lot of times it has happened with me when I was in the corporate world, and I'm also culprit. I'll call my team member and say, yeah, you do this, it is very urgent. Huh? After 1 hour later, I'll say, yaar, ye bhi kar lena, ye bhi thoda urgent hai. By the fifth time I go, I say, ye bhi urgent hai, the guy is confused ki what is urgent now. Paanch cheeze ho gayi uske paas. But remember, he is now in the constant state of arousal. His ability to contribute, add value would be? Do you want that with your team members? So what do we do? For example, when we are training, I do a lot of training at Reliance. What do we do? After every 90 minutes, what do? We take a break. Because they are also getting new information. Where are they processing it? Here, not here, here. And going beyond 90 minutes to 2 hours will bring down the ability to absorb and learn. A lot of times if you go to, I don't know whether it happens here, you have meetings which go to 4 hours, yes or no? One of the good practice could be, don't get tea into the room after 90 minutes. Get tea outside. Walk out for 10 minutes. Have a cup of tea, discuss something else and come back. You will actually benefit by quality of thinking later. You may still reach your objectives and decisions, but the qualitative aspect of those decisions and discussions will be much higher if you do not stay in that arousal state for a longer time of 3-4 hours. In any case, honestly, hand on your heart, if you are in a meeting for 4 hours, theoretically from 9 to 1 p.m. or 2 p.m., at what stage do you stop contributing and you slump in your chair and you start thinking about something else? Does it happen? That's of your mind, your brain, your PFC giving you a message, I can't take it more. A lot of people, especially bosses, tend to introduce humor. Humor is a good break. Humor is a good break. It sort of gives that break and then you can go back to thinking what you are thinking. So if you have to get over the roadblocks, you have to have, when I say roadblocks, which means some problems which keep occurring and you have to find a solution to that, permanent solution to that. Because if they keep recurring and you are taking decisions or actions which bring it back again and again after some time, it is only deferring it. Make sense? So you have to have new insights and new awareness. Sometimes have you noticed that some of your ideas come to you when you are having a shower or something? Why is that? Sometimes, not all the time, sometimes.
You are relaxed.
Your brain is quiet. This part of the brain is quiet at that time. It is science again which tells us that there are certain triggers of thoughts which appear in our prefrontal cortex at some point in time. And we don't hear them. Why don't we hear them? Because there is so much other things happening in our brain here right now. We are thinking of so many things simultaneously. What is going to happen in the meeting? There is a PowerPoint. I have give a call to somebody. There are so many things happening here. So therefore, for us to hear those voices, hear those triggers, which probably are answer to our recurring problems, we need to quieten our mind. Which means keep it silent sometime to be able to listen to those voices. So the slide is basically to highlight to you that we can find our own answers. We don't need to go to others to find our answers because the answer may be lying within us. But for that, we need to quieten our mind. We can't keep it in a agitated and stressed state for a long period of time because some of those flashes, some of those triggers, some of those activations may get lost if there is a lot of noise happening here, a lot of crowding happening here. A question to all of you. Quickly read this question and give me the answer. A bat and a ball cost $1.10. The bat cost $1 more than the ball. How much does the ball cost? Answer, please. 10 cent, 1 cent, right? Where is this answer coming from? Hardwired brain or prefrontal cortex? Some of you have not responded. Hanji? Hardwired. What is, you know, this question was given to Stan. You, the lady now think knows the answer. You're smiling, no? Okay, this 56% of the Stanford graduates and everybody gave a wrong answer. Now read this question carefully, slowly, and do a calculation in your head. Read it again and give me the answer. What is happening right now? Your hardwired brain is giving you an answer. And in some cases, your prefrontal cortex is coming into play to say, nahi, nahi, answer theek nahi hai. Hardwire is giving you 10 cents. But your PFC, is some people are holding it back. He says, nahi, there is some catch in this. This is not the right answer. Can you calculate the answer now? Simple mathematical problem, yes or no? Hello? Hello? 5 cents. Hello? Mathematical problem? Why did 10 cents come, or why did no answer came from your head? Now, how many such situations come to us each day, and we think we know the answer, and we do it, and yet it is not the right answer probably, not the appropriate answer. Does it give you an example? Does it give you a feeling about this thing has to be processed here, but where are we processing it? Right? And whosoever is confused, fair. You are struggling. You are struggling to say, kuch to gadbad hai. You know, there is something in this that I'm not able to figure out. Did not take out a pen and a paper. Yeah. So the question is that how many such situations come to you each day where you take decisions like that, and perhaps they are not optimal, okay? Most of the problems aren't solved rationally. 60% of the problems in the lab are not solved. They're solved in a way that people can't explain. Now, I want to show you a picture. I want you to tell me that, you know what, in Jamaica, there is a high incident of accident of bikes and deaths. Can you tell me what is the cause? Driving etiquettes, yeah. Driving etiquettes.
Distraction,
yeah. So what is it? That answer is right. Nobody has noticed that the person doesn't wear helmets there. What is this at play? What is at play here? Hello, what is at play here? R? Now, these are simple, two simple mathematical and social media problems I have thrown at you. And how have we responded to that? Does it give you an indication of what dramatically we can change at our workplace if we slow down our thinking? And there is a book called System. There is a book called Thinking Fast, Thinking Slow. Anybody? Daniel, yeah? There is a thinking two. There is thinking level one, thinking level two. Level two says create a choice in your head. Slow down yourself. Make it more focused. And sometimes when we slow down, we will find answers which are not only appropriate but more sustainable. Otherwise, the problem scheme recurring. And this is the challenge of leaders, that when they encounter problems, can they create sustainable solutions that don't allow those problems to come back again and again in that sense? Okay. Uh-huh. Now let us look at the second one, staying cool under pressure. Neuroscience, again, research tells us that when we were millions of years ago, we were not even fully standing humans. There was no prefrontal cortex. We only had this brain. Over a period of time, as we evolved, the prefrontal cortex has come to human beings. And it is said that typically animals don't have a prefrontal cortex. They still have this. That's the research or whatever they say, right? So there is a part of the brain which makes us, first we think something, right? Something comes to us, we start thinking about it. That thinking creates a feeling. Where does that feeling come from before it goes into the heart is in the part of the brain. So if this is the brain, total brain, this, how do I show it? Huh? You see the PFC is in the front, right? And then you see a limbic system. Limbic system is in central part of the brain, which is where the emotions come up, the feelings come up, right? Sad, angry, fear, frustrated, anger, threat, and so on and so forth. And there is a small piece called amygdala. It is almost like an, what is this, almond, no? Almond? Almond? This is an almond, huh? Walnut or almond?
Almond.
Almond. Almond. It's an almond-sized piece of thing in our head, in our brain. Now, I'll give you a small description or a detail here. The trigger of anything happens outside. The stimuli comes from outside, goes to our PFC, travels back into this brain, and generates emotion, right? Because one of the organizing principle organizing principle of our brain is it sees everything from two perspectives: reward, threat. Reward, threat. Is that making sense to you? Anything which happens, we, our brains are organizing that information as a reward or a threat. My boss calls me suddenly at 7 a.m. in the morning, and I see the hello number, and I start thinking of something, and immediately as I think of that, I start having a feeling also. So what is happening is that this stimuli of a phone creates a thinking in my head. That thinking is caught by our limbic system, which generates emotion, and then we act. Now, I said that the brain has an organizing principle, reward or threat. And I'm going to go deep into it in the next part. But that determines how we will act. So as leaders, it is our job, it is our responsibility, it is our obligation to give those external stimuli in a manner that they are received as or perceived as what? Reward or threat? Reward. But on a day-to-day basis, we do so many things as leaders and managers that we are giving threat. And when you look, the boss will say, "Yaar, maine call hi to kiya tha." Is it not? The boss will say, "What happened? Yaar, I just called at 7 a.m. What is so?" But we are not aware that call at 7 a.m. is being received in a manner as seen as threatening call. Threatening call. So we are sometimes not aware of how our actions, but the brain is organizing every piece of information as, okay, let me take an example. There's a lady sitting here, right? Can you raise your hand? Look, now she is seeing a threat. Therefore, she is saying, is it me or is it somebody else? Am I right? Maine haath khada kiya, mujhse sawal to nahi pooch lenge kuch. What will I say? Hello? No, not you. I'm talking to her. Yeah. Sorry. But, and I just wanted to give you an example. It happens like that. Our brain is always looking at reward. That's an organizing principle. I don't determine it, it's the brain. This is how it functions. So if theoretically, this is the response, what happens is, when it looks at a threat response, good response is a good response. When it looks at the threat response, it generalizes more. What does it do? Generalizes more. Life to aise hi hone wali hai. Kuch nahi ho sakta. You know, you just cloud it more and more, make it more halo than what it is. It errs on the side of pessimism. Simple to understand? Errs on the side of pessimism. Impacts working memory. So remember, when it creates a threat response, the working memory, the PFC, is getting impacted. Let us go back to the same example I gave you of the phone at 7 a.m. Now, although I have kept the phone upside down and walked away, what do you think is happening in my working memory? Hello? Did you mean? At 7 a.m., my boss calls. I feel a threat, ya kya ho gaya, kuch garbad ho gaya kya? And I keep the phone upside down or keep it in silent mode, and I walk away, physically walk away. But yet, what will be happening in my working memory? Still thinking. It is engaged, right? If it was doing some productive job, the brain, it will go back to keep worrying about it. Kya ho gaya, kya ho gaya? Maybe I will go and open an email. Koi email bheji thi, maine jawab to nahi diya, uska ke bhool gaya jawab dena maine. Or maybe a customer complaint has come, I have not addressed it. Something. But working memory is now engaged. It is not being productive. And this I'm talking about early morning. Imagine this happening at workplace. Imagine this happening at workplace. I'll give you an example. Let us say you are sitting and working on something. And you get a call. And you pick up the phone. And the person on the other side says, "See me immediately." Is it Will it give a reward response or a threat response to my brain? Threat response. What will happen now?
Reflecting what all you have done.
Laptop, either, paper, either. Pata nahi kya pooch lenge. Hai na? Kya maang lenge. Does it happen? Some of you are laughing, I think, are experiencing it with, from bosses who are in this room also. I'm just kidding. Does it happen?
Yeah.
I'm only trying to explain to you that brain is only looking at organizing every information as a reward or a threat. But if I do the same phone call and I say, Deepak, yeah, I have this urgent thing which is happening. If you have time, can we talk about it right now? Will it be a reward or a threat response? What? I'm saying almost, I'm calling him still, but maybe I'm spending 3 seconds more and saying it in a different way. And what do you think will happen from the other side? The guy said, sir, anything specifically you are looking for? Nahin, nahin, yaar, tu aa ja, bas baith ke tere saath brainstorming karni, or something like that. Yeah. And you will find a completely, the working memory is now much more freer, much more in a better shape to be able to focus and discuss on this thing, right? So that's the impact on the derailed by drama. Drama ho jata na bahut yahan par. And I told you when there is drama happening here, what happens? Energy intensive hai, it's small. It almost clogs, it doesn't work. Drowning amid uncertainty, one have example, the expectations out of control. So this is very, very important, which I tell you that reward and threat. Bad in our brain is very strong. That limbic system actually takes over. And I forgot to tell you this, that when our limbic system takes over and creates a threat, our amygdala, this part, the almond in the brain, only forces us to do 2-3 things. One is fight, one is flight and freeze, which means it's almost like an angry reaction. You have an accident and you say, "Maar dunga." There is no pause created. PFC is not at play. Hardwiring is at play. A negative emotion is at play, and you immediately respond. And typically, amygdala takes over. We call it amygdala hijack. You understand hijack? Jab wo hijack kar leta na aapke brain ko, phir aapko kuch nahi dikhta. Nothing matters to you. Your voice will go up. You will be very aggressive. In an angry situation, you will just do what you want to do, highway or my way. That's what happens. It is called amygdala hijack if you want to go and read more about it, right? So if you start creating a threat response, if your messages, your actions as leaders are creating those, imagine what is happening to the team member, yeah? Okay, so this is about the threat response. So how do you stay cool? One, of course, is reprisal. In the same situation, reprisal is looking at the same thing in a different way. What is reprisal? Looking at the same thing, but in a different way. So when this phone call comes, being mindful that this call never comes from my boss, and if it is coming, and unfortunately, I was thinking that all of you have done the emotional intelligence piece. Emotional intelligence piece tells us, which is also an important thing for leaders, is that we need to be aware of our emotions as they happen to us. So if this call has come to me at 7 a.m. and I'm starting fearful, am I aware that I'm feeling fearful? Because if I'm not aware that I'm not feeling fearful, any action that I take, I cannot change. Does it make sense to you? But if I become aware that I'm being fearful, then I have a hope that I can ask a question. Why am I fearing this? Yeah, it is ultimately a call, right? That will allow me that 5-6 seconds to think and say, can there be something else just beyond work? Because my boss normally does not call at 7 a.m. And that reprisal only will help you not cloud your working memory. Otherwise, once you cloud it, you will remain under stress. You can't stay calm. And the second piece that I talked about is mindfulness. Mindfulness is in here in the moment, with no hardwiring impacting, no reward threat, just being in the moment. There's a call which has come, let me pick up and see what it is. Let me listen to what the person has to say. As a simple example I'm taking. To stay cool under pressure and to stay out of stress, it is important to not let our working memory get clouded by the limbic system response, which is a threat response. Threat clouds us, threat holds us, it makes us fight, flight or freeze wherever we are. Now look at this this piece, which is now about collaborating with others. You want all of people to work with you. So there is a model which is called SCARF model, S-C-A-R-F, right? Each alphabet stands for a word. The first word is status. Can you see that? SCARF and S is status. SCARF ka jo S hai, wo status hai. Our brain is constantly monitoring our status in a group, relatively. Our brain is constantly. You walk into a social situation, our brain will start looking at, I'm not saying you will, okay, am I looking the best in this party? Right? Am I getting more handshakes from people? I enter a meeting room with my boss, am I closer to the boss versus somebody else? Our brain is constantly assigning a number to us in our group. It's science. You may say no, but it is. You may be managing it better, but it is always doing this. Now what it does therefore is, when you feel like going up in status, it creates a toward emotion. What is a toward emotion? A positive emotion. You feel good about it, right? When his boss was calling him every day in the morning, he was facing a what? His status was going up. That boss only talks to me among so many people, and therefore his status is going up in his brain. He is getting a higher ranking and therefore feeling good. But the day his boss stopped calling, that status seemingly was coming down, right? And that is creating a threat response to him, and therefore he starts thinking, kya ho gaya? What has happened? Have I done something wrong? Right? Now, let us apply it to your work situation. You give feedbacks to people? Hello? You do annual performance appraisal discussions with your people? Right? Now, these are the two, I've just picked up two sample pieces. These are the two activities that you do which have a huge impact on the status that this brain is looking for in those conversations. You understand what I'm saying? So, now tell me honestly, you are talking to your team member, you say, come yaar, I have to give you some feedback. As soon as you hear the word feedback, what thinking goes in your head? I want to give you some feedback after that meeting, no? Please come and see me. Hello?
Negative.
Does it appear as threat? Ab mujhe bataya jayega maine kya nahi kiya ya kya galat kiya, right? How is your state of mind when you sit in front of your boss to listen to it? You become defensive. No, no, sir, justification and all that. Because that process is bringing down your status. You are being told not good enough, right? Making sense to you? You do it every day, virtually, giving feedback to people, receiving feedback from people, right? Second is appraisal. I was talking to before the session began. In appraisal also the same thing happens. We all are afraid of appraisals, right or wrong? Hello? Appraisal discussions? This question itself is a threat. Is it not? This question itself is a threat. It's giving a... Okay. Now, what do you do? What can you do to reduce the threat? Let us say you have to give feedback to people. It's a very regular activity for leaders and managers, yes or no? What can you do to reduce the threat? I want to give him a feedback. And I pick up the phone and I say, can you see me? We have had this meeting, this presentation to the client, right? And I saw something there and I want to give you feedback about that. Fair? How can I make that feedback less threatening for him, so that he sees it as a reward response and not as a threat response, so that he listens and acts on it also, na? Feedback is for what? For improvement. But if the person doesn't listen because his working memory is now engaged in the threat drama which has been created, then what? Now let me tell you the two sides of it in the same context. One of the thing is seek on feedback. One of the ways of reducing the threat of status is, first ask the person, how do you think you did in this presentation today? How do you think you did in this presentation today? Or in that situation, wherever you want to give a feedback, or he has prepared a report to be sent to the seniors and you want to discuss with him because you find there's something which can be done. So you call him and says, okay, what do you think of this report? He'll say, sir, I have done it. No, you have done it, but what do you think? What are the good things about this? If you were to give in half an hour more, what changes will you bring to it? Seek his own feedback. That's one way to reduce the threat and improve his improve the impact. What else can you do? What does it say? Contribute, include in plans and discussion. Now, sometimes, this is another dimension of status, is that we sometimes create committees and groups of people working on a problem. Do you do that? Hello? Right? But there are some people who are not part of that group or committee, they are out. What do you think they are discussing? What are they thinking? So I have a problem and I say, three of you will work, and there are five people in the room. Three of you will work on this. What do you think are the other two people thinking of in terms of status? Is the status going up or coming down?
Coming down.
Yeah. So as leaders, sometimes you're not conscious of this. But remember, the brain of those two gentlemen is receiving it as what? Lowering of his status in that. Why am I not included? Now let me tell you a science here. When the MRI imaging of this brain was done, when there was a physical pain with somebody, let us say you put a knife through the leg of somebody, a certain part of the brain lights up in the MRI imaging, right? It turns red and bluish light, right? The same part of the brain lights up if somebody is socially excluded. You understand? Socially. When we look at some of these, those people who are into crimes and all, and we say they come from those parts of the society which are down and out, what are they facing? They are facing lowering of status all the time. They are the have-nots of the society in that sense, right? They are experiencing a pain, and that pain makes them do what they were doing. So it applies to organizations also. We sometimes, not knowingly, but unknowingly, take certain actions which lowers the status for some people. We are not doing it intentionally at all, I agree. But the brain. And those two people will go out and say, ye toh favorites hai inke. I will now do what I am told to do. I am not going to do anything extra. They will not come and tell you this, but they have experienced that. So social exclusion, sometimes the way we form committees and teams, without telling people what is the reason, what is the basis for it, can cause that lowering of status. So contribute and include in plan and discussion. So in the same situation, ask all five of them that we can have only three people in the meeting. Can you discuss amongst yourself and tell me which three would like to be here and walk out of the room? What are you doing there? By giving them the autonomy, by giving them the power of deciding themselves, what are you doing? Raising their status in their head. And that's when they will contribute and add. And when the decision comes, all five are going to feel good about it, even the one who are not on it. And some of the things that you said about increasing the reward, give positive feedback also. You know, a lot of times we don't give positive feedbacks. We say, positive feedback to yaar kya improve karna hai na. We will focus on things which need to be improved. But every time we give only negative feedback in the form of saying improve, 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 the person starts to think, and therefore, it starts impacting his ability to contribute. And of course, one way you can always enhance the status of people is by supporting them in their training and in their this thing. You understand what I'm saying? So essentially, remember, status is a very, very important thing for all of us in this room. A lot of people who come into the room, and I'm being honest about it, would have decided to leave the first chair and sit in the back. Some of you, yes or no? How do you feel about it, that you did not come up and sat in the front seats? Students in classes who do not perform well, when they come into the room, which seats do they select? Because in their own mind, they have lowered their status to say, because our number doesn't come, we will sit back. People are sitting in front whose number is good. You understand what I'm saying? So this is all at play. The point is, how do you translate it into workplace and involve your team members better? The next part is certainty. in the scarf, what is the next word? C. That's certainty. Our brain loves to be stable and loves certainty. You give it uncertainty, it creates threat to the brain. Same example, come and see me now. Uncertainty, no? Kya discuss hone wala hai? What has happened? It impacts the people. Okay, so like I said, as soon as you sense uncertainty, it gives a limbic system response, which is a threat response. Understand? Amygdala at work. Kya ho gaya? There is a risk, there is a fear there, right? And then, in other words, we experience more of away emotions. Now, what do you do for certainty? Large projects, bring them into smaller pieces. Give people the big picture. Give people to understand. I normally give this example of that once in NASA, a janitor, you understand a janitor? The housekeeping guy, let me put it that way, was asked, what do you do? What did he say? He says, what do you do at NASA? Right, he says, I send people to the moon. I help people go to moon. He did not say, I clean the things, right? When we start giving certainty to people of them and their work and their contribution, you will find huge positive response from them in terms of contribution and value adds, okay? Establish clear expectations of what might happen. Now, this is another insight, and you can add more to it. A lot of times we delegate a lot of work to our people, okay? Do you do that? Delegate work to your people? You say, this is something that I want you to do. They go out and the works don't get done. Does it happen? Yes? And when they don't get done, you ask them what happened. He says, no, sir, what I was thinking was if. I kept thinking if. Does it happen? Yeah? Because there is uncertainty in their head, it immobilizes them. It almost freezes them because there is a threat response there. So what do you need to do as a manager, as a leader, when you are assigning work to people? One is to clearly state that this is the end deliverable. What else can you say that can give them the certainty?
Be accountable.
Be accountable, which means deliverable. You said you will do it, and therefore deliver what you have said you will do it. Right? That's one. What else? If you get stuck, come back to me. Fair enough. So you are saying, yeah? So you are saying what might happen? That there may be situations where you might get stuck. Okay? What else can you do? Asking him by when can you complete it? Now, what is the certainty you are creating by asking this question?
Buy-in.
And by asking this question, what are you doing is you are improving his status also. You are involving him in that process of setting timelines or targets. The status also goes up. Otherwise, you can say, is tarikh tak kar dena. Yeah. What else? Sorry?
It's a teamwork.
Teamwork, yeah. What else?
You can also add innovation to it.
So you can always tell him that there are certain pieces I also don't understand. I'm expecting you to work out in detail and do it. So create a expectation, but certainty as well, that these pieces, even I don't know, so don't come to me. It's entirely up to you how you want to do it. Another thing which you can do is, sometimes we know that there are some points of failure which might happen. It will be okay for you to say that you might face the challenges here, here, and here. You might fail here, here, and here. Create a certainty in his head that it is okay that if things do not go right, maybe. It is okay. But I am available, like somebody said here, I am available, that if you feel this is happening, please come back to me and we will redraw the plans and so on. So create certainty. Uncertainty kills. It allows the brain to get hijacked by your limbic system. How do you increase the reward? This is very, very important. And you can apply it in a larger context also. You can create certainty by doing these three things. Tell people what you want to do or what you want to say. Then do what you have told them you will do, or say what you have said, you will say. And then, finally, having done it, tell them this is what we have done. And if you have said it, say this is what we have said. So create a complete loop. Anyone has been to a church? Learn to a pastor in church, anyone? No? If you go to church, the priest, when they are giving their sessions, they do this piece very well. They will tell you what they are going to tell you. Then they tell you what they have told, they will tell you. And then they will tell you that we told we will tell you and we have told you. You don't understand what I'm saying? Yeah. So it creates a certainty, right? A lot of times our meetings become stressful. Do they or do they not? Why? And what can we do to make it less stressful and more certain? When meetings are called by us, right? What can we do so that it becomes less stressful for our people and it helps them by when we create certainty? What can we do about those meetings? Sorry? You are only people in the front rows are speaking. All the, what is it? I want some responses from the back also.
Let's change the
seating.
Let's change the seating?
Yeah, let's back benches come in front and we go back. No, no, look, back benches are not there. They are sitting back. हाँ पीछे से भी बोलिएगा कुछ अगर आपके आइडिया आए तो या गो अहेड एजेंडा यू हैव गिवन दैट इज वन वे टू से दैट इन दिस मीटिंग वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस द फॉलोइंग व्हाट एल्स कैन यू डू टू रिड्यूस द अनसर्टेनिटी ड्यूरेशन ऑफ मीटिंग बी स्पेसिफाइड लेट अस से दिस इज अ वन आवर मीटिंग ओके व्हाट एल्स आउटकम दैट वी डिजायर यस आउटकम या व्हाट एल्स हाँ जी प्रेजिंग विच मीन्स इन द मीटिंग हाईलाइट द गुड थिंग्स ओके सम मोर पॉइंट्स अबाउट हाउ कैन यू क्रिएट सर्टेनिटी दिस इज अ रेगुलर फीचर ना बीइंग कॉल्ड फॉर मीटिंग्स वंडरफुल सो कैन यू सेंड अ मेल टू दीपक सहनी से दीपक आई वॉन्ट दिस एक्सपेक्टेड फ्रॉम यू इज दिस ब्रिंग द फॉलोइंग डेटा और सो एंड सो ब्रिंग द फॉलोइंग इन्फॉर्मेशन ऐसा ना हो कि वो मीटिंग में आए एंड देन से मुझे वो डेटा चाहिए था बट इट सेड दिस डेटा आई थॉट वाज नॉट रिलेटेड टू दिस कॉन्वर्सेशन देयरफॉर आई डिड नॉट ब्रिंग इट सो रिड्यूस द अनसर्टेनिटी मेनी मोर आइडियाज कैन कम इन एंड आई थिंक 5-6 हैव कम इन हियर एंड दिस इज जस्ट वन एग्जाम्पल ऑफ दिस अ लार्जर एग्जाम्पल ऑफ सर्टेनिटी इज अबाउट हाउ विल आई बी रिवॉर्डेड एंड रेटेड एंड अप्रेज्ड दैट्स द बिगेस्ट अनसर्टेनिटी पीपल समटाइम्स डू नॉट इवन नो How will their performance be evaluated at the end of a project or and so on and so forth? Because a new surprise is sprung on them. Tumne ye kiya, par wo nahi kiya. I'm not blaming you all. There are realities of professional life. But the more we can reduce those uncertainties, the better it is for our own growth and our people's growth and performance. Autonomy. What does autonomy mean?
More power.
Yeah. The brain wants to have a say. It has to have a say in the future. It wants to have a say. It wants to predict the future, right? And if it is not able to do that, what does it do? It creates a threat response for the brain. Hanji? It creates a threat response for the brain. Let us look at some example of this. How can you reduce the threat? Anyone have heard of coaching? Coaching? What is coaching? Hello? Coaching?
Yes, sir.
What is coaching? What does a coach do which, Hanji?
Embedding,
okay. What is one key thing a coach does?
Polishes
your talent. And how does he do that?
By making you look inward and...
By making you look inward. How does he make you look inward? What does he do that you start looking inward?
He demonstrates.
What else does he do?
He asks you questions.
Which you yourself answer. So autonomy is about brain having a say in the future. So when it comes to controlling the environment, what you have to do is do not tell, ask. So I go to him for advice. I say, this is what I want to do. Now, if you want to help me, rather than telling me, ask first. What do you have in mind? What have you thought of? What do you want to do in this situation? And make me speak first before you start giving advice. Because advice, therefore, doesn't work or doesn't get acted upon. So do not tell, ask people. Now, let me put it this way. A lot of time, people will come to you and say, sir, this is the problem. What do we do? We give. What do? We start with a solution. So what is the assumption we have made here? As soon as somebody says, I have a problem, and I respond, what is the assumption we have made here? he doesn't know it. And let us say he does exactly what you told him to do, and it doesn't work, then when he comes back, what will he say? He comes to you with this problem, you give the solution, he goes and executes the solution, comes back to you because that solution has not worked, and he will come back to you. What will he say to you? Sir, aapne jo bola tha, wo nahi hua. Haan, par aapne mauka diya usko? Did you give him an opportunity? Did you ask him? You went into the mode of telling. Now, why telling is not good, but why asking is good is because our brain that gets involved. It takes the ownership to say, I have to find a solution which works. Otherwise, I'm working on your brain. So in that sense, giving autonomy, giving the brain an opportunity to have a predict, a say in the future of whatever it is being done. Future, it should not be seen as a 5-year perspective. Future about tomorrow, about day after, in that sense. Is he contributing to that? That is important. Offer choices. Also, let them set their own goals and timetables. One activity that our brain likes the most. Can you tell me what is that activity? Now you should, after 1.5 hours. One activity our brain likes the most. It is almost like an exercise for it, for fitness freaks. Like exercise gives you those good hormones, no? Right? Chemicals, huh? Thinking. Once you can get your people to start thinking, they are going to be an asset for you. To be able to make them think, you have to ask. Once you ask, their brains get activated. They start predicting their own future. They build their own certainties in whatever they want to do. They decide where they want to be, what they want to do. Keeping, ultimately, they are working in the organization. They will follow those goals, but they are having much more say. Now, I want you to reflect on your own team members, right? And look at a bright performer, great performer, versus somebody who's average or below average, right? What are the distinct differences you see in the way they function, not what they do, in the way they function or think? What do you see? A bright performer, results achieved, amazing, versus somebody who's average. What is the distinction? Sorry? They ask questions, and what happens when they ask questions? Why are they asking questions? Because they want clarity. Right? More certainty maybe? Yeah? Okay. So the point I'm trying to make is that by adopting some of these practices and many more, we don't have time, we don't have a full day session where we can do exercises, you can engage and get your people to collaborate better. And collaboration is all about new ideas, new solutions to old problems. Then comes the relatedness. Relatedness is about, do I belong, right? Do I belong? Are people that I work with are friends? It is about trust. Hello? This is about trust in the group. Relatedness. And what do you do today as leaders and managers that gives them this good hormone, cortisol as they call it, decrease the stress hormone, but give a good dopamine into their brains, and they feel they belong here. The other piece is share personal aspects through stories. We call it self-disclosure. You understand what is self-disclosure? Apne baare mein pehle batana. Apne baare mein khud batana. Sharing something about yourself. It could be about your life, your likes and dislikes. For example, one of my self-disclosure story with most people is that when I came out of school, I did not know how to speak in English. I did not know how to speak in English. And it is so ironic. I used to be in English medium school for all you know, but I did not know how to speak English. People would ask me, what is your name? And then I would respond, but you asked me to speak for 5 minutes in English? I can't. I couldn't. And then I joined a company called Bharat Petroleum. And there, in Delhi, and there were these Delhi boys, they would speak in English, and I started feeling status-wise where? So I became almost like an introvert. I would not go and to those meetings or those situations where they are partying on a Saturday because they will all speak in English. I started withdrawing myself. And then I had an army friend. He right now works for you, and his name is Sanjeev Sharma. from OTS Chennai. OTS? OTS it is called? OTA. And so I talked to him. He used to live, I belong to a place called Meerut. Some of you know it. It used to be one of the biggest cantonment at one time. Right? Sorry? You are from Meerut? No. So I talked to him. I said, yeah, I can't speak English. I just can't speak English. I'm terrified in situations when I have to speak English. So he told me four things to do. And I did all those four things. And I became better in English. Now what am I doing right now? I've shared a very personal thing. Some people will be fearful of this story, right? Here am I, and at 50 years of age, telling you that when I was 18, 19, 20, I could not speak extempore in English. A lot of people will be fearful of this, yes or no?
Yes.
But I have shared it. But as soon as I shared it, what has happened in this room? Can you tell me what is happening to you right now? What are you thinking about me?
Connecting with you.
Connecting with me. Maybe that's your story also. Maybe that is your story also. Even if it is not your story, how do you feel now towards me? What are you? Huh?
We're empathetic
with you. We are empathetic with you. Yeah, he came, we went through that situation for 3-4 years or whatever, right? Now, when we talk about share personal aspects through stories, this is a story, no? I'm not saying I was weak in English. I have told you a story. When you share stories about your life, you start building closeness and bondness with your team members. You start doing that. Because now people relate to you on a very, not just a professional level, at a very personal level. You are as vulnerable as they are. You understand vulnerability? Vulnerability is weakness. A lot of times we are told leaders are not vulnerable. The most effective leaders are the most vulnerable leaders who are willing to say that I don't know. We hardly say that, right? As managers and leaders, we don't say, no, I don't know. We always have to have an answer for every problem. So if you start sharing, self-disclosing, people come to you and say, this is the problem. I was looking for a solution from you. If you turn around and tell him, honestly speaking, I also don't have an answer to that. Can you work on it and bring out a solution? What do you think will happen? If you tell them that I don't think I have the answer or solution to this problem to them, what will they think? What will they feel? These are new thoughts, huh? These thoughts have, huh? Hello? Have you turned around and said that I don't know as a boss? Hello? Once again. Answer is in this mobile or no? I thought you were looking into
Google.
Huh? The visa card is pito. Yeah. Have you tried this anytime? As a boss turned around and said, I don't know, yeah, really, this seems to be a ticklish problem. I have no answer to this. Why don't you figure it out yourself? Done it? Yes or no, yeah?
Yes.
And what has happened then? Hanji? What has happened after that? Has he gone out? Huh, Bali? More motivated. Right, yeah. Now, here again, we have to overcome that hardwiring that we have in our head, which says that the manager has to have the answer always. Remember what I told you. You are now managing a generation in a manner in which you have not been managed earlier. So your learning is limited to the way you have been managed. You don't even know. Therefore, admitting your vulnerabilities, sharing your own stories about your challenges are going to build these bonds. How do you increase the reward? Demonstrate building new relationships, social contacts. People who are sitting on the fringes, bring them into this. Help people build safe connections. I'm getting repetitive now because all of this is connected. Let us go into the fairness part. The brain loves fairness. Everyone loves fairness? Everyone loves fair. Fairness not in fair and lovely. Fairness as in fairness. Huh? Sabko ek jaise ek hi aankh se dekhna, as they say, na? Unbiased, fairness, right? First of all, and this is important, and especially since I work with Reliance Leadership University, there is this huge quote by Mrs. Nita Ambani about diversity at workplace, right? And there are ladies in this room as well. When it comes to assigning projects, do we just assign projects thinking on the capabilities, or we decide, oh, this is a male versus female situation? Even that is fairness. And there are ladies in this room, they may be, I'm just saying, I'm not saying you are, you may be feeling sometimes that you have been dealt with unfairly just because you are a female. Tell me, are you going to hate me for this? Has it happened with you? No? Fair enough. Some of you, some of the times? Huh? Yeah, look, HR person is saying which is everybody else. Yeah. So the point I'm making is that even that is fairness. We sometimes do not see that. Because we let our perceptions, you know, this is an outdoor job. I cannot give it to the females. You know, they can't go and work till 8 p.m. in the night. Fair enough. That's what you think. But can you call that person and say, I have a challenging role. It requires you to travel three days in a month or 4 days in a month. You have to be in remote locations. Are you up to it? Let her have a say. Let her say, no, I can't. Then fairly give it to it. But seemingly without involving them would be giving them a message that you are not being fair. They may love to do that project or that job for that, all you know. And later may come and say, and you will turn out sheepish, you know what, my mistake. I thought you will not be able to go. You have a small child and so on and so forth. You understand what I'm saying? Fairness, very, do not create different rules. Be transparent and communicate more of why. Like I said, if I give the project to him, am I taking the effort? Leadership is not easy. Leadership, first of all, is a choice. Leadership is a? How many of you are making this choice consciously to be a leader? Leadership is the choice. You have to make a choice to be a leader because being leader is not easy. Hello? Huh? Right. Therefore, there has to be much more done by leaders and managers of teams to be able to deserve their role and their position. And there, you know, sometimes we just tend to overlook some of these things. We say, samajh jayega wo. And in leadership and in change, they say three things are very important. You know what are those three things? In leadership, when you are a leader, or when you are bringing about a change, three things are important. The first one is communication. What is the second one? Communication. Which is the third one? Communication. Because only through communication, you share yourself, you share your thinking, share who you are, share what motivates you, share what could be good for others in your head, and why you are doing what you are doing, why you are saying what you are saying. No amount of communication by a leader is good enough, is considered good enough. And communication is the only way to do it. Increase the reward. I'm repeating myself. And I call it a scarf model. I call it a leader's attitude. Scarf is a leader's attitude. You have seen a scarf? How is a scarf worn? Huh? Scarf ko aise pehante hain na gale mein. Men especially. How do they wear scarf? Men. Army people wear that scarf, right? Around the neck. And as soon as you wear it, how do you start looking? How do you start feeling? Status goes up. So it is an attitude. You're standing slightly stylishly. So it goes up. So a leader also, leader always has to wear scarf. He has to take care that he provides status to his team members, certainty to his team members. What else? Autonomy. Relatedness and fairness to the team members. Okay, in this piece we have discussed it. Last we come to change. It is a small piece and I want to just focus on these two last slides. If you focus on a problem, what did I say? The problem gets more hardwired. Where do you have to focus on? The solution, the new wire that you have to create, right? Now, I'll do this, it's a 30-second exercise. I want you to stop thinking of pink elephant for the next 30 seconds. Do not think about it. Why is that? When I said stop thinking, why were you only thinking of pink elephant? Not to think. So it's like smoking, not smoke. What is happening? You're still smoking. Right? So when you have to bring about change, where should your focus be? The new. The new vision. The new picture of the future. That's what change is all about. But if you keep focusing on, you know, this is the problem, this is the problem, that's why we have to change, the problem is getting, and people are not seeing that. The more you, and if I make it a positive one, this is, start thinking about a future when everyone has a home and a car and food and shelter, how will the things change? You will only think of that. So bringing about a change is, first of all, bringing about a change in our head to start thinking of that desired future that you have in the organization. It could be about your vision, vision of your team, mission of your team, or even goal of your team. Thank you so much.
Any other questions? So this is an insightful session by Mr. Sawhney on the neuroscience of leadership. It was insightful to see how our brains are rewired, everything for us to unique in their own way. The examples given would help us in using our brains better in different situations. Mr. Sawhney, on behalf of everybody present in this room, please accept our appreciation for sharing your time and experience with us.
Thank you.
Can we have a round of applause?